Greeks did some measurements of the distance. You know, they were rudimentary, but they calculated the distance from the Earth to the Sun. They were the first to have an idea of just how large the solar system was, at least in relation to the fact that, you know, the Earth, the relationship of the Sun and the Earth.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Astronomy. The study of how the stars and planets move in the sky and universe has largely been a hobby for humankind, going back to the ancient Greeks, and in certain cases, even farther back. For centuries, the sky has fascinated scholar and common man alike. For a substantial amount of time, within the pre-Copernican era, all of the denizens of the world essentially knew that there were points of lights in the sky, and that selected ones moved, called planets. There was a large, bright light during the day that warmed the Earth, and a bright, silvery figure at night that would change its form. But due to the unknown qualities of these figures, they were commonly adapted to religious ideologies, such as Antinism in Egypt in 14th century BCE, or the common belief in the church at the time that the Earth and Moon were created by God, and thus they must be perfect in every way. However, around the 17th century, the sayings of the church were accepted as gospel truth, as much of society as that time was focused around the religion, and the church held a colossal amount of power.
We knew next to nothing about the universe that we lived in. We knew that there were pinpoints of light in the sky, but we had no idea how far away they were or what they were. We knew a couple of them moved. We knew there was a big bright light during the day. We had no idea what it was, but we knew that it, you know, warmed the Earth. But other than that, we had no idea what they were. So they became essentially just religious symbols and ways of managing our time and the calendar.
Within this pre-Copernican era, a substantial chunk of astronomy was related to the principles of Aristotle. Aristotle was a Greek and had fundamental theories that there were four separate areas of physical matter: earth, wind, fire, and water. He put the Earth as a center of the universe. There were seven wandering stars, which were the planets at the time because they didn't follow the regular pattern as other stars did. To Aristotle, the celestial bodies were composed of a completely different element, one such element that caused them to rotate around the Earth in perfect circular movements, as opposed to the earthly elements that just shifted vertically depending on their weight. These ideas were the basis upon which many astronomers of the time based their ideologies. Going back in time to ancient Greece, we come to find a man named Aristarchus. Around 280 to 260 BCE, Aristarchus was an astronomer. Even living at that time, Aristarchus was able to estimate the relative distances of the Earth to the Sun and the Moon to the Earth, and use those in order to predict the size of each of these astronomical objects. Aristarchus' findings weren't all mathematically sound, though. His prediction that the Sun was 19 times of the Earth, when in reality it is 390 times larger. However, this did not interfere with his reasoning that because the Sun was so much larger than the Earth must revolve around the Sun instead of the Sun revolving around the Earth. This is the fundamental idea that fuels this theory that came to revolutionize the entire world. After Ptolemy came Copernicus, who was one to work on astronomy on his own. Around the years 1510 and 1514, Copernicus wrote what came to be recognized as a commentariolus. This described the idea of a heliocentric theory, this cosmological idealism in which the Sun has replaced the Earth as the true center of the universe. He continued making astronomical observations, but due to the poor location for them, he was often constrained throughout his work. Nonetheless, he continued his work on the revolutions. He also wrote The Letter Against Warner in 1524, which was essentially a critique of Johann Warner's previous letter concerning the motion of the eighth sphere. Copernicus claimed that Warner was wrong when it came to his calculations of time and his belief that before Ptolemy, the movement of the fixed stars was uniform, but Copernicus' letter did not refer to his own ideas of how the universe worked. As time progressed, the telescope was slowly developed into a usable piece of technology. While the true beginnings of the telescope are shrouded in mystery and ambiguity, the main accreditation can be given to Hans Lippershey. The telescope was not invented by any one person, quite the contrary. At the time, many people had their own twist to the telescope, leading to a plethora of different telescopes. The telescope made by Hans was not the first telescope by any means. However, it was in 1608 when he applied for a patent that we can generally accept as one of the first, more clear examples of the telescope's past, even if said patent was denied. The telescope's uses were abundant. It was employed for militaristic purposes, but it wasn't until people took their focus from the ground to the sky that the telescope started its revolution of the world. One such individual that took hold of the telescope and put his own spin on it was none other than Galileo Galilei. In 1610, using his own improved version, a 3-power spyglass which had dwarfed previous known telescopes in terms of distance and power of magnification, Galileo discovered and observed Jupiter's 4 moons along with a few star formations. Galileo wrote a book on his findings named Sidereus Nunicus in Latin, or The Starry Messenger in English. Although news had quickly spread of Galileo's discoveries, it took several months for others to create a telescope to match the magnitude of Galileo's spyglass. This delay would prevent immediate and sensible feedback towards his work. He continued his research later and discovered sunspots on the sun, and also documented the several phases of Venus. All of his research resulted in the support and approval of the Copernicus system against the previously acknowledged geocentric theory. It wasn't until 1632 when Galileo wrote Dialogue Concerning the Two Chief World Systems that an argument between the two known universal systems erupted. In Dialogue Concerning the Two Chief World Systems, Galileo explains his theories and observations that contradict the widely accepted ideas of the Church and Aristotle.
Galileo's observation of what became known as the Galilean moons of Jupiter, the four brighter moons of Jupiter, where he documented that they were in fact moons orbiting Jupiter, was probably just as damning evidence as anything else, because the church doctrine was that nothing revolved around anything except that everything revolved around the Earth. If everything revolved around the Earth, how could something be revolving around Jupiter? And that was kind of hard evidence. And that got him into a lot of hot water.
Galileo's findings were not widely received. In fact, the Inquisition, perpetuated by the Catholic Church at the time, completely rejected Galileo's findings even when he had the evidence to back it up. Galileo's findings proved the moon to be craggy and rocky on the surface, as opposed to the belief in the church that it was a perfect sphere with no imperfections. They didn't just blurt this out to the general public, though. Many of the actions that the Inquisition took were hidden. Galileo's findings not only proved the geocentric theory wrong, it made the church wrong. A church that, at the time, was the foundation of many people's lives. Introducing this new heliocentric theory could cause the church to look bad and undermine the power that the church had amassed. In 1616, Pope Paul V declared that the heliocentric theory was a lie. Galileo was charged with heresy and placed under house arrest. Within his sentence, Galileo was tortured until he admitted his findings were incorrect, and afterwards he was placed under house arrest for the entirety of his life. At the period of its spreading across the world, the telescope brought with it a new innovation and reforms in both military combat and astronomical findings. With each new form the telescope came in, a new revolution occurred. The telescope was the piece of the puzzle that proved and solidified the belief in the heliocentric theory to be correct. At the time, this entire belief system that Earth was being the center of the universe was flipped around. The entire idealism that people based their lives on was ripped right out from under their noses. Telescopes have not only impacted the world of the past, they have also paved the way for the future. Without telescopes, modern photography would be non-existent. With the aid of telescopes, we were able to change a rudimentary view of the universe into a quizzical and ever-expanding one. It wasn't until 1992 did the Vatican formally acknowledge that its actions against Galileo were wrong and Galileo's findings were correct. With all the information that we have learned about both humans, religion, science, and space, it's a wonder how the telescope's impact on the entire human race can be briefed over so simply. Who knows? New innovations in telescope may be the final puzzle piece to seeing if we are not alone in the universe.